What is a security? Now, many people think, at least on the first glance or the first blush, that we're talking about stocks and bonds. But in reality, under the law, a security is much more than that. There are a variety of investments. We'll talk about them. But at the heart of it, from a legal perspective, a security is a passive investment in an enterprise with an expectation of profit through the works of others. Now, when we talk about a passive investment, and we'll get to this, and maybe I can actually use this, we're talking about an investor who is not involved in the business. We're talking about someone who, in a sense, is making an investment of money and expecting to gain from that on the basis of somebody else doing the work. They're not involved in the decision making beyond the decision to put the money into that enterprise. What can a security be? One of the biggest ones that you'll see up there, or one of the broadest ones, are the investment contracts. But securities can be prom notes, promissory notes, stocks. They can be certificates of interest. They can be a profit sharing agreement. They can be any of these various types of products that you see. And especially in the broadest scale, they can be an investment contract. There is a United States Supreme Court decision, the Howie decision, which is a federal case, but in that it defined what is an investment contract, and quite honestly, it's used both by state regulators or state authorities and federal authorities to determine whether the sort of investment that we're talking about is in fact an investment contract and therefore is a security. It is a contract, as you can tell, or a transaction or scheme whereby a person, again, invests in a common enterprise with the expectation of profit, and that profit will be made solely from the efforts of the promoter or a third party. That's what we're talking about when we talk about a passive investment. What is a common enterprise? And again, we're going to go through some of these things, but they're important that we talk about them so that if and when the Securities Commission comes to you with a case to talk to about a potential prosecution, you know some of the questions to ask to find out if it's going to get over that initial threshold. Is this a security, and is it something that's a crime? What is a common enterprise? It can be something like a corporation or an LLC or an LLP, but it can also, ladies and gentlemen, be a project like an investment in oil well or gas or energy production. It is an investment in what is purported to be you're making a share off the profits from ATMs. There actually have been, some of them are legitimate investments, but selling people an interest in an ATM sounds like, on the face of it, to be that's just a no-brainer. You know, people are putting money in and they're taking money out and you're charging them fees. And, you know, if I put my money in, the profits will be enormous, and we'll share those profits with you. It's not listed up here, but I know there's a mention of it later in the materials. In North Carolina, within the last 10 years, we had our office began an investigation of a very complicated scheme on the face of it, what we call the mobile billboards case. The promoters told the potential investors that their investment would be used to purchase run a series of mobile billboards. Has anybody ever seen a mobile billboard? So there are actually mobile billboards out there, just like their payphones and their ATMs. And the promoters, again, spoke very highly of this, told their potential investors what marvelous returns they were going to get on it. The unfortunate part was that when they took the money, they weren't actually investing it in any mobile billboards at all. They were using it to pay themselves outlandish salaries, to pay commissions to the salespeople that were running this. It was so complicated and so involved in such a large-scale operation that just last, I believe it was last year, it might have been the end of the year before that, the United States Attorney for the Eastern District of North Carolina prosecuted a lawyer out of Atlanta who was heavily involved in creating the appearance that mobile billboards was in fact a legitimate, profitable company. He's now serving time in federal prison. So there are a variety of undertakings or projects which can be the basis for a common enterprise, or it can be, for example, an investment program as it, you know, in a retirement or annuity product. There are different ways that the federal courts define the structure of a common enterprise. And quite honestly, this is one of those areas where I may have to call upon my colleagues in the state regulator's office to answer questions about it. But it's pretty straightforward. There are some federal courts, the majority of the federal courts, I believe, the majority of the federal courts sort of have a horizontal structure which they use to evaluate whether it is a common enterprise. In a horizontal structure, obviously, there are a lot of investors who are putting their money in, and each investor sort of shares the risk of profit or loss. In a narrow vertical structure, which quite honestly is, according to my notes, is only applied by the Ninth Circuit, it can be, although it could be more than, it can be simply a single investor who with money linked to the promoter, and again, between the promoter and the investor, they are supposed to be sharing the risk of profit and loss. The final one, which is called a broad vertical, is a test for the structure of a common enterprise applied only by the 5th and 11th circuits in the federal court system. The initial efforts to regulate the securities industry in the United States was begun by the states. Back in 1911 in Kansas, the first comprehensive state securities regulation, the laws were created and passed. They were designed at the time, as you can tell, to regulate the offering and sale of securities to the public. There were a number of those laws were called the Blue Sky Laws, and I'll explain that in just a minute. They were adopted by many other states, and among the first states to adopt those original Blue Sky Laws were West Virginia and Arizona. The focus of the securities regulation at that time was much more limited than it is now, because originally they only applied to corporations that were selling securities within a given or within the state that had passed the law. They're called the Blue Skies Laws because the banking commissioner, Joseph Dolley, in Kansas was the one who advocated for the law. And as you can tell from the slide, he was talking about those investment opportunities in which, as it says here, the promoter promises rain but delivers only blue sky. Historically, he was at a legislative hearing when the law had been proposed and the legislature in Kansas was trying to decide whether to pass it or not. And one of the senators asked Mr. Dolley, what would you suggest that we call it? And he pointed back to a situation which most of the folks in Kansas were familiar with, in which a slickster from Chicago came to Kansas during a drought and convinced a number of people in one of the areas that he had a system which would make it rain. But he needed money, their investment, to accomplish that. And the story goes that after 4 days of watching this person blowing what appeared to be chemicals into the sky and still there was no rain, the townspeople who had invested went out to the location and found that the slickster had taken their money and left, and all they were left with was blue sky. So when you hear state regulation or state laws referred to as blue sky laws, that is, as I understand it, the source of that title or name. Now, since the original blue sky laws were passed, many of the states have now adopted what we call in a general way the Uniform Securities Act. Each state makes certain tweaks, as we all do with uniform acts, but each state has certain aspects of it that are different. I can talk to you about the North Carolina law. Jeff is going to talk to you a little bit in a more West Virginia specific way about the details of West Virginia securities laws. But in essence, the laws are designed to be somewhat uniform, as they ought to be with an industry or a financial sort of industry in which they're selling products not just to people in one locale in a state or in one state, but to anybody who wants to invest in or make that investment, whether they're in West Virginia or North Carolina or California. The state uniform acts, again, are designed to, first of all, regulate the industry and make sure that the people that are working in the industry are properly licensed or registered. There are certain requirements for who becomes a broker-dealer or who becomes an investment advisor or a firm. Some of that is preempted by federal laws, and again, those are subjects for a more detailed discussion of securities law. But it's the firms, it's the individuals who have to register and who have to remain registered during the time that they're working in the industry. In order to be registered, they have to take certain tests and successfully complete those tests to demonstrate that they've got sufficient knowledge and proficiency to be involved in the business. But the products, if they're legitimate securities, have to be registered with the states as well. Now, again, there are certain federal preemptions that affect what we can do and what has to be or doesn't have to be registered in the state. But the anti-fraud provisions of the states applies to anybody, whether they have some exemption that they can claim from registering in a state because of a federal law that preempts the state laws. If they're engaged in fraud, there is no preemption, and the states do and can and should prosecute those. These are just a few of the things that people have to disclose in promoting an investment product. The securities laws are not designed, and correct me if I'm wrong, but the securities laws are not designed to prevent the state citizens from making stupid decisions about how they spend their money. As long as that stupid decision is made with a full knowledge and understanding of all of the material aspects of the investment opportunity and the person that's promoting it. If any state got into the business of trying to prevent its citizens from making stupid mistakes, we'd have more than we could handle just dealing with that. As the prosecutors in the room know, the day that the legislature makes being stupid a crime, that will be the time at which we don't prosecute anything else but stupidity. We'll have a full-time job doing that. What the securities laws from a regulatory point of view are designed to do is to make sure that those people who are considering an investment have access to and are given all of the material information necessary to decide whether that's where they want to put their money or not. And it not only requires that the person, the promoter, disclose material information, it also provides that they cannot omit to provide material information. It's not just that they misrepresent some material, but if they don't tell them about something that's material, that can also be a violation of the state securities laws regulating the promotion and sale or offer to sell securities. And all of this information has to be provided before the investor invests their money. It's not enough that having put the money in, then they come back and tell them about risks that are material and would have made a difference to a reasonable person trying to decide whether to put their money in that security. And one of the things that investigators investigating these types of criminal violations, potential criminal violations, are getting a lot of information from the victims about what they were told, asking them about, were you told, but what you're looking for as an investigator are some indication as to whether the promoter or the seller or the person who was offering to sell these products was providing the material information necessary for a reasonable investor to make a decision about where to put the money. Now, there are other types of crimes that are similar to securities fraud. At a state level, we used to call, and we still do call them, Ponzi schemes. Ponzi schemes, ladies and gentlemen, is just this simple. It's robbing Peter to pay Paul. You've heard it over and over and over again. We call it a Ponzi. You can call it a Ponzi scheme, but the essence of it is that you're using the money from later investors to pay the returns to the earlier investors. Mr. Ponzi, at the turn of the 20th century, convinced a number of people in Massachusetts and the Northeast that he had figured out a way to turn incredible profits off of the buying and selling of stamps. He was kind of blurry on the details of how he was doing this, but he was a remarkable promoter. He was charismatic, he was a wonderful storyteller, and he convinced an incredible number of people to invest in his stamp trading scheme. Unfortunately for the investors, what he was doing was again, not investing in stamps at all, but investing in keeping the scheme going by using the money from recent investors to pay off the obligations he had to the earlier investors and to skim a lot of it off for himself. Theft by false pretenses. One of the things that I find in North Carolina is that very often when I draw indictments, I will draw indictments not only for the securities fraud charges, but also for false pretenses. Because in a lot of ways, false pretenses is broader, but it's the same concept when we're talking about securities fraud, with the distinction being that there's sometimes the securities laws are actually more helpful from a criminal point of view than the false pretenses charges. When we begin to talk about corporate greed and accounting fraud, we're talking about, among other things, as you can tell from the slide, insider trading. And I don't know whether or how the feds get to that first, but very often it's because the securities laws in that respect at the federal level are different than what we deal with at the state level. But the sort of insider trading or the manipulation of the records, again, we hear an awful lot about that in the paper. I really don't see a lot of that in North Carolina, but that's another form of what we call, in a broader sense, securities fraud. There are people who are soliciting investments in a Ponzi scheme at a larger level. I have a number of cases which are sad cases at one level if you look at it from the defendant's point of view, because they're constantly looking for the next best thing. They're constantly hoping that if they can get enough money to put it into this harebrained scheme, which sounds really good, or that harebrained scheme, that they will make a ton of money, and they believe it enough that they're convincing their friends and family and neighbors and church members to invest with them. Those people still tend to be charming. They're consummate salespeople. They have that attraction to risk-taking. And again, the types of people that really get my back up are those who have such an incomprehensible, almost, lack of empathy or remorse. Quite honestly, running these schemes takes money that could be invested in legitimate businesses, in communities and in states, and prevents the, actually has a detrimental consequence on our economy. I don't think that as prosecutors we will ever be able to fully eradicate con artists from our communities. But at least we get them out of our state and our community.